please the court. My name is Philip Nathanson. I represent the plaintiffs, appellants, in this case. This case is in a federal courthouse because the appellees brought it to a federal courthouse. It started out in the state court where a judgment was entered in the state court against a defendant, tortfeasor, not an insurance company or their insurance carrier.
I'm curious about Rule 69. Ordinarily, collections practice in federal court under that rule just follows whatever state collection practice is. And in this case, the state collection process is that if you garnish, most typical garnishment you see is garnishment of an unsuccessful defendant's bank account. And if the bank says the unsuccessful defendant doesn't have any money here, then in this particular state, Arizona, I think it was, the judgment creditor has to object to that within 10 days. And I'm really not clear on why that collection practice isn't carried over in the federal court here.
Well, of course, Judge Kleinfeld, we argue it's not carried over to federal court. That when you remove, when my opponents removed this case from the Superior Court of Maricopa County to the U.S. District Court, that all that existed was a state court judgment against Ms. Langemeier. There was no judgment against these insurance companies. So when the case presented itself to the federal court in Phoenix, there was no federal judgment, and Rule 69 only applies to federal judgments, not to state court judgments.
This question just is sort of a procedural puzzle I had. So you had, there was a dam run agreement,
yes.
And there was assignment of claims, but rather than take the defendant's assignment of claims against the insurance company and bring an action against them, you use this writ of garnishment procedure. And I couldn't tell from looking at Arizona state law, though there were some cases that suggested that's essentially the same thing, but that's just another method of enforcing claims under these sorts of dam run agreements. Can you explain to me how that works in Arizona?
Well, I absolutely can, Judge Ikuda. The appellees cite a case called Wojtunik versus Keeley in their brief, which is a district court case from Arizona where the district court discusses at length the procedure for litigating dam run disputes in Arizona and basically says you can go either way. You can use the garnishment process to litigate coverage and liability, or you can file a separate action. We cite other cases in our brief which say the same thing. Indeed, the district court in Wojtunik said there are numerous Arizona appellate cases allowing insurance coverage disputes to be litigated through garnishment proceedings, and that liability of an insurance company can be determined in this kind of action.
So although it's styled as a writ of garnishment, you didn't really have any judgment to enforce on. You said yourself you didn't have any judgment against the insurance company. So this is essentially the same as a civil action with the assignment of claims from the tort defendant against the insurance companies.
Indeed, and we so treated it when it was removed, that it was removed. The notice of removal says it was removed as a civil action. The answer that was filed in the federal court. I've been doing this for 36 years. I know there's no pleading after the answer in federal court unless the district court orders such a pleading to be filed. And we did not believe that we were just continuing the state court garnishment proceedings in the federal courthouse down the street. I do want to advise the court that I filed last night now in support of the argument that we have made throughout this case. Indeed, I argued to the district court below on page 10 of the appeal from the magistrate's ruling that Federal Rule 69 applies to writs of execution and enforcement of federal judgments. It does not apply to the pre-federal judgment dam run liability of these defendants. We made that argument repeatedly below. We make it at pages 9, 21, 22 and 24 of our brief. And you know, I came across this other case, which I have filed last night as supplemental authority under Rule 28J, where the district court in Michigan, dealing with a very similar situation, says Rule 69 applies only to money judgments of the federal court. And it quotes this court as saying, inasmuch as the federal courts are not appendages of the state courts, and that's the Ninth Circuit opinion in Trelkel versus Tucker, a federal court cannot enforce a state court judgment without first going through the process of a case.
What was the context of that case? I haven't read the case that you brought.
I apologize for that, Your Honor. We've just tendered it. And so the context of the case was the state court in Chicago, the circuit court in Cook County, entered a money judgment. The plaintiff took the money judgment to, I think it was Muskegon, Michigan, enrolled it in the state court in Muskegon, Michigan, and then the case was filed in the federal court, either by removal or they just went and filed in the federal court.
What's the basis for removing a money judgment as opposed to a civil action from state court to federal court? What was the basis in that case, do you recall?
I think that was an independent filing.
Okay.
And they asked for a writ of garnishment as part of a newly filed action when they were getting nowhere in the state court of Michigan. And the district court judge in Michigan in Dearborn Street Building Associates versus D&T Landholding said, I don't have jurisdiction in this case. This is just a garnishment case of a state court judgment, and dismissed the case for lack of jurisdiction. So I think it's clear that we've taken the position from day one that once they remove the case to the federal court in Phoenix, it's a civil action. It proceeds under Rule 81, which governs in the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, civil actions removed from a state court, that the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure on pleading and litigating a civil action apply, that it's not just a continuation of Arizona statutory garnishment proceedings. Obviously, our position is that if these insurance companies just wanted to litigate Arizona garnishment proceedings, they should have stayed in Arizona. Although the Arizona cases, as you asked me, Judge Aikuda, clearly say that it's a vehicle for litigating the liability of coverage disputes. There's cases with expert testimony and proceeding as a regular, as the Arizona case say, independent civil action. So, Our position before this court is...
My concern about that whole line of reasoning is that the language of Rule 69 says proceeding supplementary to and in aid of judgment of execution must accord with the procedure of the state where the court is located. And the exception that it gives is where federal statute provides otherwise. What you're saying is that if it's in federal court, then that's not so, at least as far as this garnishment goes. Is that right?
Well, what we're saying, Judge Kleinfeld, is this. When the case goes to federal court, Rule 69 applies. And I gave you the page numbers from our brief where we cited this, and we cited it in the district court as well. Rule 69 applies once there's a federal judgment.
It doesn't say that in Rule 69.
Well, it talks about money judgments and execution.
Is there any money judgment against the insurance companies at all? Is there a money judgment either in state court or federal court?
There is no judgment.
There isn't. I thought the state court entered judgment.
The state court entered judgment.
The confession of judgment.
No, the state court entered judgment, a stipulated judgment, against the insured of these insurance companies.
There is a judgment.
No, there's not a
court. And what this is garnishment on a judgment from a putative debtor of the defendant against whom judgment was.
Let me tell you why I don't think that's
not a judgment against the insurance company. There's a judgment.
settled with the insured. My client settled with the insured.
But you're trying, as I recall, you had what we used to do in Alaska was a confession of judgment, assignment of rights, and covenant not to execute against the insured. And you did basically the same thing in Arizona language.
Exactly.
Except that in Arizona, what you do is instead of bringing a separate lawsuit standing in the insured shoes, you garnish the insurance company as a debtor of the insured now that there's a money judgment against the insured.
But under Rule 69, I can't execute against the on the judgment against the insured because, as you said, I covenanted not to execute. On the judgment, the insurance company can't execute on that judgment. So it's a judgment that's a linchpin to establishing bad faith liability of the insurance company.
But your position is really the opposite of that. You're saying, although you can't execute on the judgment against the insured, you can execute on the judgment by garnishing the insurance debtor, just as in a routine collection case, if the debtor has no money, you execute only by garnishing debtors of the judgment debtor, such as the debtor's bank.
But it's not an execution because there is no money judgment against the insurance company. It is a way to establish the liability of, as a matter of first instance, of the insurance company for the...
Can you do that by objecting to the insurance company saying we don't owe the insured any money? Just as you would do it against a bank that the judgment debtor had a deposit in. If the bank said we don't owe any money because our fees absorbed all the account or something like that.
Well... The federal rules say...
Put into the account balanced.
This court has held, which we cite in our brief, that once the case is removed to federal court, the state court process becomes null and void, that it's a federal civil action or there's no jurisdiction. So once they remove the case, this...
Which was your best case for that?
I'm sorry, I had missed
it. Part I keep stumbling.
I have multiple glasses here. I apologize. Best case is I'll find it. Beecher versus Wallace. Cited at page 10 of the brief, the state court process becomes null and void on the date the action is removed to the federal court. So our position, Judge Kleinfeld, is that we were entitled to rely on the fact that if this is removed as a federal civil action, then it's going to proceed as a federal civil action under the federal rules of civil procedure. I don't know how much time I have, but I'd like to reserve the rest. Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court. My name is Randy Kingery. Also with Steve Westeros. I represent the Appalachians.
Can I ask you a question just at the outset? If we agree with your opponent that Rule 69 does not apply in this case, do you agree that your position doesn't prevail here, that you lose?
Rule 69 and what Rule 64 and...
Hang on. Yeah, yes. Just yes or no. So if Rule 69 does not apply, if we credit the argument that your opponent has made, do you lose? I just want to know so I can figure out how much I need to kind of take you down this other path, but if you're going to concede that, it makes it easy. So is that the key question for us, whether Rule 69 does or doesn't apply?
I don't think so. I don't think if Rule 69 doesn't apply, that means that we lose.
Okay, so then it seems to me you're wrong because we have to follow the Supreme Court's decision in Shady Grove, and we have a direct conflict between the Arizona rule of procedure that would otherwise govern here and the the federal rules of civil procedure. They're just in direct conflict.
Right. Which rules are in conflict?
It's rule, I think, 8B6 of the federal rules combined with rule 7A7, which, as your opponent pointed out, says that when you're in federal court and the person files an answer, you don't have a right to file a responsive pleading to that. You can only file a reply to an answer in federal court if the court orders you to do so. Rule 8B6 then says when somebody files an answer and you are not, you don't have a right to file a responsive pleading, the allegations are deemed denied if you don't say anything. So it seems to me it's exactly the opposite of the rule that prevails in these Arizona garnishment proceedings. Right?
But I think there's a distinction between an answer to a complaint and an answer. They call it an answer, but it's an answer to a garnishment. Those are two different things.
Not once you get in federal court. You've got the plaintiff's pleading, which is the complaint, effectively, that's what you removed as an independent civil action to our federal system.
Correct.
Then you all file what, under the federal rules, counts as an answer, right? I don't know what else. I mean, Rule 7 says these are the only pleadings that are permitted. Whatever that thing is you filed, I looked at it, it's kind of just a checkbox thing.
Yes, sir. But there's a distinction between an answer to a complaint and an answer to a garnishment. And the point is, Rule 64 and 69 sort of subsume.
I'm saying Rule 69 doesn't apply. I agree with your opponent. It has no application in this case because there's no federal judgment that's being executed on. So I want to hear what you have to say on that point, but if I don't accept that, then what's the argument for why you still win? That's what I'm struggling with.
Well, first off, the Ninth Circuit has recognized through Swanson that these proceedings are removable. Every case that we've cited from the district court, the district courts in Arizona have applied these very rules. This is how they're done. This is how it's happened. I'm aware of nothing that changes that. I'm aware of absolutely no authority, and I don't think they've given you any that leads to the conclusion that once a garnishment proceeding under Arizona state law is removed, it transforms it into another.
It's an independent civil action. That's the only way under 1441 you can remove it. So once it's in our system, we play by the federal rules, and the federal rules are 7A7 and 8B6. It just seems to me that, and Shady Grove tells us, that unless that those rules are somehow invalid, they govern, notwithstanding some disparate state rule.
Well, I still think there's a distinction between the rule 7 in the federal rules, which talks about an answer to a complaint, and a strictly statutory Arizona garnishment proceeding, which by all accounts, to my knowledge, all of the courts that accept the removability of a garnishment proceeding follow the procedure of the state from where it came.
Are you saying that that's it's substantive? Because if it's procedural, then of course the federal rules would supersede. Are you saying that the elements of the garnishment action are substantive?
Well, I think they're substantive in terms of the Arizona garnishment rules are substantive, yes. But I think they're also sort of a hybrid. They're also procedural in the fact that, in particular, Rule 64 of the federal rules and Rule 69 compel us to use, and they require us to use the Arizona state law.
Right, but that's only after a judgment in federal court or it's been litigated to completion in federal court. And, of course, this hasn't. This is just the initiation of an action against the insurance companies. Right.
Well,
so 64 is inapplicable for the same reason 69 is inapplicable. They both use the same, similar language.
Well, give us your best case for why Rule 69 applies here, because I completely agree with Judge Good. I don't see how it could possibly apply. But what's your best case for saying that it does?
First off, I'm not sure that there's any authority that says that it doesn't. All of the authority that we have is that it does.
Give me one case that says it does in this situation.
I believe the Watch Unit case applied Rule 69. I think there was an estate of
Marcos case?
Yeah, but that case, that, I'm not familiar with the first one, but the Loral case that you're talking about, if that's the case where...
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that, there's a federal court judgment there. That's what's different. There was a judgment entered in a federal court action, and that's why Rule 69 governs. I'm talking about when you have a state court judgment, or here we don't even have a state court judgment against the relevant parties that gets removed to federal court. What authority do you have that says in that circumstance Rule 69 governs?
I think the overarching point is, for us, there's nothing that changes the substance of what this is. It's an Arizona garnishment action that's been removed. We change the form, but we don't change the form. And all of the federal rules that I'm aware of require us to use the state court setup for garnishments. Does that make sense?
No.
If you have a case, I'd love to hear it, but you haven't, you didn't cite any cases other than once, at least the one I'm familiar with. There was an underlying federal court judgment, which is what triggered Rule 69.
The Granny Goose case talks about this to some degree, and I'll give you the quote. Held, Rule 64 codifies, quote, long-settled federal law providing that in all cases in federal court, and here's the key, whether or not removed from state court, comma, state law is incorporated to determine the availability of dot, 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 proper to do secure satisfaction of the judgment.
If the action is removed from state court and is litigated in federal court and results in a federal court judgment, sure, then Rule 69 applies. But I'm saying give me one case where there's not an underlying federal court judgment that was entered in federal court, right, where Rule 69 was deemed to apply. You might say, well, we don't have cases one way or the other. Well, I look at the rule, and it seems to me it can only apply to a judgment entered in federal court. That's why it's in the federal rules of civil procedure.
I'm not aware of any specific case that outlines that directly.
How about this? Let me just try to turn you back then. Let's say that we reject your position that Rule 69 is the controlling rule here, and we just treat this as it's an independent civil action. It gets removed to federal court. You wanted to argue, and I was resisting it, that you nonetheless still win, notwithstanding this conflict between Rule 8b-6 and the Arizona rule. Maybe just take another stab at why in that, when that conflict occurs, why does the Arizona rule trump the federal rule?
The Ninth Circuit recognizes these cases are removable. The bellwether to decide whether they're removable is whether the state treats the case as one that's an independent civil action. Our state does. There's the Blum case. I don't think anybody disputes that. Once that occurs, there's simply no law that requires us to take ourselves outside of the Arizona garnishment procedures. There's just not.
Other than the federal rules, right? I mean, so a civil action then is removed. It's an independent civil action of 1441A. And then it's a civil action in federal court, and so the federal procedural rules apply. And so to the extent the Arizona state statute sets out procedural rules for how the time frames for responding, they are superseded in federal court by the federal procedures. Why isn't that correct? I mean, that is what the rules say, and that's also my understanding from my civil procedures class way back.
Well, Rules 64 and 69 both refer us back to the Arizona state.
There's an underlying confusion here.
Yeah.
And that is, what is the difference between an independent civil action and a collection proceeding? In most states, it's pretty obvious where you have a confession of judgment, assignment of rights, and covenant not to execute. There's a separate action at that point
our state has told us through the Blum case that it is an independent civil action, and it can be brought in many different ways.
Sorry, I missed a couple words there.
Arizona has determined that it is an individual civil action. The Blum case tells us that. That's the bellwether as to determination whether the case can be removed. Here,
once you say it is an independent civil action, though, then you run into the problem of whether the Arizona procedure applies to it. Because that Arizona procedure that we're talking about importing through Rule 69 is just a collection process procedure.
Well, it can be brought as many different things. It can be brought as a garnishment. It can be brought as a complaint. Plaintiff could have sought to bring this as a complaint alleging breach of contract, bad faith, whatever they chose to do. They chose the avenue of garnishment. The insurance carriers have the right to remove it, to change the forum, and that's what happened here. So I don't know if that answers your question.
But obviously in federal court, it's not just a collection action because there's no judgment against the insurance company.
There's no judgment against the insurance
company. So they have to litigate their case to show that the insurance company should have tendered a defense or tendered or indemnified the defendant.
Absolutely. And the key to that door for the plaintiff appellant to do that is to file the objection to the answers that were made by the insurance carriers.
But given that's an independent action, I mean, I guess that's just once it's an independent action against the insurance company as it goes into federal court, that's, as I think Judge Wofford said, we play by federal rules. I guess that's the stumbling block for us federal judges.
And I'm not sure that the federal rules do apply. Rule 81 applies, but 81 is limited to the idea that they don't have to replead. The case law states, and I'm sure it's in our papers, that once it's removed, it's simply in the same position it was the day it was removed. And that's how those are dealt with.
So what we wind up with is that if it's a judgment in federal court, then we would apply the garnishment procedure that's used in state court. But if it's a judgment in state court, removed to federal court, we don't.
Well, I think you apply all of the rules, and I think you apply the federal rules to the extent they don't.
Well, a judgment wouldn't be removable to federal court, right? I mean, only a civil action is removable.
Correct. And the courts have determined that a garnishment is a civil action.
The civil action, you do have this Ninth Circuit law that says a garnishment is removable, which seems funny to me because the civil action is really the plaintiff against the policyholder. And the garnishment is like when the judge from plaintiff garnishes money from the judgment debtor's employer or bank account. Garnishment of wages. Those are all treated as independent actions in Arizona.
Yes. The Blum case talks about that very issue. It's a separate issue. Plaintiff appellants could have brought it anyway. They chose the garnishment procedure. They didn't follow it. Doesn't magically transform it into something else.
We have your argument. Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to speak to Judge Watford's point, just a couple quick points. The Arizona Garnishment Statute, ARS 12-1581A, states if no written objection to the answer is timely filed, the court shall enter judgment discharging the garnishee. So our position, just to be clear, is there is a direct clash, obviously, as the court said. Second point. The cases cited by the insurance companies here from the district court in Arizona, as we say in...
I'm not sure whether there's a clash because Rule 8 controls pleadings. It used to be that with common law pleadings in some states, there had to be a reply to an answer. And Rule 8 says you don't need to do that and can't do that in federal court. However, objection proceedings in federal court are
I come from Illinois, where you have to file a reply to all affirmative defenses under the Illinois Code of Civil Procedure.
That's exactly what the federal rule says you don't have to do in federal court.
I agree with that. And here, as Judge Watford said, once they file an answer saying we don't owe you anything, everything after that under the federal rules is deemed to be denied by us. All the district court cases they cite talking about Rule 69 did involve, as Judge Watford said, federal judgments. There is no case where a federal district court just enforced Rule 69 by itself.
Let me ask you something that's hypothetical. Suppose a routine collection case, and suppose a routine circumstance in the collection case, the judgment debtor has no money. The only way to get money is to garnish his wages and garnish whatever he may have in his bank account. I know in state court what you would do is look at the state statutes and the state rules in order to get your process issued and served on the bank and the employer in order to garnish the wages and garnish the bank account. Now, if you had a federal judgment in Arizona, what would you do to get the money out of the bank account and to garnish the wages?
Well, the case is, in fact, the case we cite in our supplemental letter says, if you have a federal judgment, that is when the federal court should look to state and can look to state court.
Follow the Arizona procedure.
Unless it conflicts with a federal statute, which Rule 69 talks about.
You're saying that if you were garnishing on a federal judgment obtained in Arizona, then the garnishee would or would not have to say, we don't owe the judgment debtor any money, and the judgment creditor would or would not have to say, we disagree.
If you have a federal judgment against the relevant...
You don't get a federal judgment against the employer.
Right.
And you don't get a federal judgment against the bank. The judgment is against the judgment debtor, and you just use garnishment against the bank.
As a third-party respondent to respond to the judgment. That's the whole point here. These folks are not third-party respondents. We're trying to impose...
That's the only... didn't bring a separate lawsuit against the insurance company.
We didn't.
So they are third party.
Well, respect.
The judgment debtor.
That's true. What we did in the state court. Once they remove it to federal court, they're defendants in a federal civil action from our point of view, Judge Kleinfeld.
But I don't think there was a summons and complaint served on the insurance company in federal court. I don't think the insurance company was sued.
No, they removed it to federal court, so I didn't have to serve them on anything. They served me with the notice of removal and
never sued in state court.
Well,
nobody ever sued the insurance company.
After the jury trial and the stipulated judgment, we issued the garnishment process and served them with the garnishment process, which, as I said before, became null and void once they removed it to federal court as a civil action. I mean, that's...
What we're saying here is you use the state collection process on a federal judgment, but you don't use the state collection process on a state judgment if it's removed to federal court.
We are saying that because in our position is there is no subject matter jurisdiction in the U.S. District Court to just be a collection arm of the state court for a state court judgment.
That makes a lot of sense to me, except binding precedent says the opposite, that garnishment is removed.
Well, garnishment is removable, but that doesn't control whether it proceeds as a civil action like any other civil action or whether I have to file a reply to the answer. I mean, as a general proposition, the Swanson case says garnishment is removable as an independent civil action, but that sort of begs the question here, their citation of it.
Does that mean I have to file a reply like I wouldn't have to do in other federal civil actions? So the fact that it's removable, okay. My position has always been in this case, if it's a civil action and I can litigate it under the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, okay, I didn't file a motion to remand the case to the state court. But when the magistrate and the district judge said, no, it's not going under Rule 81, it's going under Rule 69, and the magistrate said, which was confirmed by the district court, this is not a civil action. So I don't think, respectfully, Judge Kleinfeld, the issue is just, is garnishment removable? If so, then what happens? I don't want to take up too much time here, unless the court has further, I'd be happy to answer any question. I don't want to cut. Thank you. Appreciate it.